Thank you very much. So I'm going to okay. Finally, I'm going to ask, how many people have even heard the word biochar? Excellent. You know, that's because biochar had alternative facts before alternative facts were cool. And one of the things that I want to do is not resort to alternative facts. I want to actually try to convince you that biochar is worth it and is actually a unique component in a healthy soil. Now, biochar has been in soil for 600 million years because Mother Nature puts it in with forest fires. But if you're not taking forest soil and using it for growing, you don't necessarily have an automatic source of biochar in your soil. But let's go through and try to create in your mind, because one of the things I've learned about soil people is they're very good at imagining the materials they're working with and imagining what the crops want. So we probably have all seen this before. This is the famous why do biochar, and that's because if we don't convert the biomass to this new form, call it biochar, we get the degradation, the composting, whether it's intentional or by Mother Nature, over 5 to 10 years. And so what we do in biochar is we do something called pyrolysis, and we'll see that a bit, but that's not what we're gonna talk a lot about. We're gonna do something to it, make it entirely different. And now it has this new property that half of it's gone, and the other half is much, much slower in breaking down. In fact, that line is essentially flat for about 1,000 years. So this is a big difference, because when we're talking about biochar, we're not talking about a fertilizer. We're talking about adding a component to your soil that is going to stay there year after year after year. The only real mechanism for biochar to leave your soil is to be essentially washed away, erosion. So if you have an erosion problem, you have more problems than just losing your biochar, because your topsoil is probably missing also. So let me show you the changes that happen with this biochar, this pyrolysis step. So what this is a couple little samples of wood pellets. And what I did was I dried them out. That's the dried, and then I cooked them very precisely to 200 degrees C, 225, 250, 275, and 300. So, and we see, and this section in the center here is actually called torrefaction. It means roasting in French. It's like you roast coffee beans. And we see them go from the uncooked form all the way to this very brown form. And finally, at 300 degrees C, things turn black. So that's the sort of first appearance change. Then I decided to say, well, is it water resistant? So I filled them all up with water. Now, everyone knows that wood pellets, if they get wet, swell up like ticks, and that's indeed what happened over on the left here. But as we look at this spectrum across, we notice that 200 and 225, we're still seeing a lot of color in the water. We're seeing a lot of distortion in the pellet that was original. These are all wood pellets. But by the time I get to 275, I can see the clear liquid through, and it turns out 300 is even more resistant. So we've created a new material at 300 degrees C that is no longer interacting with the soil water. So it's not going to fall apart. It's not going to pull up, it's not going to take up water itself, and it's not going to break down in the presence of water. Furthermore, if I drain them, I notice that on the 200 and the 225, I've got mold growing on top. So I still have in these materials sugars leaching out, and the ability to support microbial degradation. By the time I get to 300, I have a material that's completely resistant to that. Not 100%, but 90%. So a great deal of these materials have been converted to a new form that is, in fact, resistant to microbial degradation. This is a very important concept. We've heard a lot about the importance of microbial soils, and it's very true. But when I put biochar in a microbial soil, I don't have the problem of the microbe breaking the biochar down and it having to be replenished. Big deal. So now I want to come up with some things that make it worth doing. We've convinced ourselves it'll be there for a while. So the reason this happens is if I look at the constituents of all plants, I've got hemicellulose, cellulose, and lignin. And what happens is by the time I get to that blue line, that torrefaction area, every portion has gone through a limited devolatilization and carbonization. fancy words for meaning the molecules all got scrambled around. It turned into a new material. So in biochar, the molecules are provided by the plant as it grows. The structure is created by the biochar conversion process. It rearranges the molecules into this new form. How much of a rearrangement? Well, this is a depiction of the inside of a plant. And that's that mixture of cellulose and hemicellulose and lignin and all the other hydroxypropylene-rich glycol proteins that, you know, toss around. And I take this in, I heat this up. Again, we saw this complete conversion. If we get to 300, it turns black, and now I've extensively devolatilized and carbonized. I start with this, and I go to that. It's entirely different. It's a new set of chemical entities. These are these graphene sheets, the chicken wire that we all learned to sort of cringe at in high school chemistry. So it's a very different structure, and each of the colors is really, it's all the same material. We're just trying to show you how large these little graphene portions are. The other important part about this is it's got an awful lot of voidage. It's got a lot of room in there. So, two curves here. One is the yield curve. One of the things about biochar is I do take a lot of material off and I send it off. So I lose, by the time I get to 300, I lose 70%. So of 100 pounds, the blue line comes down to 70 by 300. And by 400, I'm down to just above 30%. So only a third is surviving. So a lot of material, that's the devolatilization, taking off the volatiles. And the carbonization is the making of a more carbon-rich solid. And that's what I'm building up. It turns out that the yield flattens out, but I have this new property called absorption. Now, absorption is the property that activated carbon has. And my guess is that virtually no one in the soil world knows how much absorption capacity their soil contains. You may have measured your soil organic matter, you may have measured your soil organic carbon level, but you've never partitioned it down to try to figure out, of that carbon, how much of it is bug food versus this recalcitrant form that's stable. And that's because this is really not a soil science thing. This is a chemistry and an activated carbon thing. The important concept is, although the material turned black at 300, I really have a ways to go. To develop this property, I actually have to go all the way up to 600 degrees C under certain conditions. They bounce around a bit. But the bottom line is this, and this is a very important concept. So Dale, write this down, please, Dale. I need you to write this down. There's a difference between charcoal and biochar. Just like there's a difference between rare prime rib and stew meat. They're both beef, but they are cooked to very different endpoints, and they are intended. One is used to feed football teams before they have to go out and do battle. The other is used for geriatric people who don't have teeth. So we're trying to achieve a slightly different endpoint. So the real difference, so if you're making charcoal, you're making it down here at 300 degrees C. I go all the way up to 600, I get this increase in this absorption property. I want this absorption property, and we'll see why in a moment. So that's the problem with charcoal fines, is they weren't cooked to the right endpoint. And it is possible that after a couple of years, you'll have some residual carbon that has some value. It is true that that charcoal quite often has a portion of quite stable carbon present, but you won't get the soil interaction properties that we're about to look at. And that's my pitch for biochar is why I use it, because it makes growing systems more robust and it makes them easier to live with. They're more productive. Do it for all those selfish reasons. So if I look at a bag of biochar, I actually have a couple different ingredients that are there, and they don't interact a whole lot. I'd like to break them out for you. Moisture, well, moisture comes and goes in soil. So let's kind of set that aside. Inorganic, which is often called the ash content, is that non-organic portion. And that's, in fact, whatever came in with the biomass. It doesn't leave in the process of being heated up. It doesn't escape. The ammonia, nitrogen probably does a bit. But as a rule, the ash is concentrated up because of the weight loss. And if I've got a raw material that's bringing in a plant nutrient because it had an ash component, so I have something like corn stover that has a fair amount of potassium and phosphorus in it, that'll be concentrated up in the ash, and it may well be a beneficial component in the biochar. Now, it's really not going to be a significant source of the plant nutrient. It's not really a logical way to fertilize your crop by adding lots and lots of biochar, because the ash in good biochar is 5 to 10%. Some biochars are intentionally made with quite high ash levels, and most of that ash is lime. So we've actually intentionally created a lime biochar mixture, which is great if you're going to be putting lime down also. So it's an opportunity to take one material into your field and get both those amendments put in. Beyond that, we go into the mobile matter and the resident matter. These are the two partitionings of the organic materials. Now, the mobile matter is essentially sugars. That's the leachable sugars that are going to come out. It's going to be just a carbon source, like you have a C to N ratio, and you worry about, when you put a lot of biochar in, having that surge of available sugars create a nitrogen deficiency, because it feeds the microbes, and the microbes scavenge the nitrogen. But if I look at the resident matter, that's the graphene, that's the stuff that's going to be there for 1,000 years. I now have some new properties. One is cation exchange capacity. That's a property most soil scientists are used to. It's not unique to biochar. You can certainly get cation exchange capacity with other soil amendments, peat and clay and things like that. Biochar does have a little bit, but that's not really the driver. The one that's unique is absorption. We're now bringing in this new property, and we'll explain how it works. And the last one, amazingly, and probably one of the most significant one, is air. It's a very, very low density material. It's full of holes. So if I had 6 drums of biochar, 2 of the drums would actually consist of the holes between the particles of biochar. So a third is interstitial between particles. The other 4 drums that contain the pure biochar, if I took all the solids and melted them down somehow and created just a pure graphite block, would occupy only 1/2 to 1 of the remaining 4 drums. The other 3 to 3.5 drums is micropores located inside the biochar particles. Very, very small, but very, very rigid, and they don't collapse. So there's some numbers just to back that up, but that's mostly because we're recording it and people may want to dissect it. And never disagree with a chemical engineer when he's got a microphone, all right? All right, so now I'm going to do something that I stumbled onto a while back that just amazed me. In soil, you guys, you soil scientists, have pores, right? And of course, these pores are classified in 3 groups. They're called macropores, mesopores, and micropores. And we use that to define the water holding capacity, and we basically say the macropores are so big they drain after the rain, and the micropores are so small they fill up with water, but it's too tightly bound by capillary forces for the plant to pull it out, and the stuff in between in the mesopores is what's available from a flood to the next time it's a drought, the wilting point. And these sizes, 75 microns to 30 microns, not a huge difference. You know, it's the micropore is 40% of the size of a macropore. So it's a narrow band. And in activated carbon and in biochar, we also have pores. These are little structures we see on the right. These are the nooks and crannies in between the graphene sheets. And of course, being good scientists, we name them. And we name them macropores, mesopores, and micropores. Good system, except these are now measured in something called NMs, which is nanometers. And nanometers are 1,000 times smaller than the micrometers. So that's the big change. All of a sudden, I've got the biggest pore in biochar is much, much, much smaller than the smallest pore in the soil. So it turns out that bacteria, which is the smallest of this soil food web, are small enough to swim around inside of the micropores in soil. But they are much, much larger than any of the activated or biochar pores. To give you an idea of the difference, if a micropore in biochar was a drop of water, a micropore in soil would be 20 Olympic-sized swimming pools, which would be more. And that's the difference. What biochar has created in the soil when you put it in there is an extension of the pore structure beyond the micropore that you have in normal soil. In normal soil, the micropore is a place, it's swimming pools full of bacteria, but biochar, it continues all the way down to pores that are the size of the bacteria, and then further down to the point of much smaller than the bacteria. So what we see when we add biochar is we get that little bump in cation exchange capacity. And frankly, most of that is due to absorption, and that's because the biochar absorbs humic and fulvic acids when they're present in the soil water and stores them. So it actually pulls them out when they're rotting in the fall, and then it makes them available during the growing season. I get this new absorption capacity, and we're gonna learn a bit more about that. And then I get my 3.5 drums of stable pores. So these can flood with water, or these can drain and be full of air, but they won't collapse. So what I'm thinking is I should go down to T's place and replace the field with biochar so it doesn't compact. And then when he goes back, he'll be surprised. Should we do it? It'd be cool, right? So, traditional soil pores are involved with the storage of soil water and are measuring field capacity. So these are basically large reservoirs of water that the plant uses between irrigation events, whether it's natural precipitation or irrigation. When I add biochar, I now have created this new material, this graphite structure, and I've interspersed it in the soil. It has the property of being able to absorb, take up soil organic matter, any soluble organics. And when they're in excess, it takes them out, and then when there's a deficiency, it will actually diffuse them back. And that's typically between growing seasons. And so we have the ability to store between crops, when there's no exudates, we have the ability to have a carbon source that diffuses back out, and this is very pivotal in the survival of the microbial population between crops. Frankly, being a bug in the soil is a good gig if you've got a crop that's feeding you every day. One day someone comes through and whacks the crop and there's nothing to eat tomorrow. And you have to go and find other sources and you try to stabilize the microbial population. And that's where the small amount of soil organic matter that the biochar has absorbed and then re-releases is pivotal. But the other thing that is really, really important is the fact that it takes up toxic compounds. Now, I know that an organic growing system has no toxicity in it, ever. Except, of course, if it happens to be located somewhere like on the planet Earth, in which case there may have been a legacy chemical left behind, good old glyphosate. Alternately, there are other chemicals come from plants that grow routinely. Some plants put out alleochemicals to repel other plants for competing for turf, walnuts and hemlocks and things like that. In fact, virtually all crops leave a non-biodegradable residue of their own behind that tends to accumulate and inhibit themselves. That's why monocropping corn on the same land year after year after year after year gets very problematic. It's poisoning its own. What the biochar does is it actually cleans those soluble inhibitors, those growth inhibitors up during the growing season, and then between crops, it actually diffuses them back out and the bugs eat them as food, and they're gone. And that's why that cycle can repeat itself, that charging and uncharging cycle year after year after year. So it's stable and it acts in this reservoir manner. In terms of the microbes, because we've created this continuum of pores, we now have protective habitat for mostly these intercropped periods where the bugs can go form spores or they can hide away and not get wiped out. It stabilizes the soil conditions. This gets a little complicated. It turns out that the interaction between water vapor and biochar is one of the nastiest things you can ever be forced to learn. I won't do that to you. But it's really cool, except, I mean, it's cool like quantum mechanics is cool. I mean, quantum mechanics really is cool. You just never understand it. So, and then the last thing, and this has been shown in many studies, that the terra preta soils that you've heard about, the black earths, that when they're wetted at the end of a dormant season, the microbiology populations rapidly develop faster than the adjacent soils, which means the biochar was providing a better survival mechanism, whether it's a better cave to hide in or a more stable environment for humidity extremes or whatever. The point is you come out of the dormancy with a leg up on the next growing season. So, what it comes down to is this. Turns out biochar has got lots and lots and lots and lots of little layers in it. So if I mentally put a quarter inch of biochar down on the surface of my garden and I work it in, it has the same effect as if I was to weave 100,000 sheets of graphite throughout the entire garden. I mean, in terms of the surface area and the places that bugs can go hang out and hide, in terms of places that chemicals can get attached and removed from the soluble water, this is just huge amounts of additional interaction in the soil. And all of these 100,000 sheets of graphite are taking up chemicals and cleaning the soil water, and then they're making those chemicals back available at other times in the growing cycle. The bottom line is because biochar and soil and microbes co-evolved over 600 million years, they work synergistically with each other. And basically what it comes down to is biochar helps the soil deliver more nutrients and growth and productivity to the plants. Some of that is just reducing the stresses associated with droughts and the oscillations in soil temperature, et cetera. And then the really cool part is it not only does it does it every season for centuries. People ask me, do you have to put it down again? I go, yes. Every 1,000 years, go out and put some more down. Don't lollygag. You're welcome to be a couple of years earlier, but yeah. So biochar's here. It's been here for 600 million years. We're now figuring out how to make it, how to tell good biochar from bad biochar, and it's taken a while. It has taken a while, but I think we're there now. And I would say, if you're a curious grower, you ought to check it out in some capacity. I'm not saying switch over entirely. It took you a decade to switch from till to no-till, but you're not going back. And I would say access it and try it out. If it's worth the work, find it. It's probably going to become more available and more affordable as the market develops in volume. But I would certainly hope that you don't look back in 25 years and finally try it and say, damn, 24 years late, this would have made my life a lot easier. Thank you very much.